So what happens when we need to represent numbers with fractions? So far, we've covered integer types only. For real numbers, we have two data types for fractional numbers, and again, in different sizes. The two data types are float and double. Float is short for floating point, and double just means double-sized floating point. These primitives are used to represent real numbers in Java. The goals for this lesson are to learn about floating point numbers, also known as real numbers, fractional numbers, decimal numbers, or numbers from the continuous number line. You'll also learn about how floating point numbers are stored differently than integers. You'll learn that computers are great for whole numbers, but they can really suck when you're trying to add decimal numbers. So we're finally going to talk about when floating point numbers go bad. Before we dive into the floating point numbers, let's review. We can represent numbers as binary numbers. They follow the same pattern as decimal numbers. Instead of being to the power of 10, it's to the power of 2. So instead of 1, 10, 100, 1000, etc., each bit is 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, and so on. We covered this in the lesson, How Do Computers Store Numbers? Binary numbers work the same way for fractions. Just as 0.1 is really 1 over 10, the first fractional bit for a binary number is 1 over 2. Then it's 1 over 4, 1 over 8, and so on, which are just powers of 2. So if we took 1.75 decimal, in binary, it would be 1.11. The whole 1 is 2 to the power 0. The first fractional digit is 1 over 2, and the second is 1 over 4. 1 over 2 plus 1 over 4 is 3 over 4, or 0.75. Plus 2 to the 0 power for our 1 equals 1.75. If you remember scientific notation, that works too. Take the decimal number 101.3. That's 1.013 times 10 to the 2. So if we had a binary number 101.11, that's represented as 1.0111 times 2 to the second power. You're probably asking, well, what does this all mean for floating point numbers? The float can represent numbers from, well, this one to that one. The numbers can be positive or negative. The bits are ordered a different way than they were for integers. It's got three parts: the sign, the exponent, and the mantissa. The first bit says that if a number is positive or negative, that's the sign bit. The mantissa is our number in 23 bits, normalized as a scientific notation number. The exponent is 8 bits, and it's like the exponent in our binary scientific notation, but the exponent is biased.
The word biased is an engineering thing. What it means in this case is we're shifting the value by 127. So if the value in the exponent is 3, what it really means is 127 plus 3, or 130. So why would you want to do that? Well, we want negative exponents too. And this way we can represent fractional numbers that have no whole part.
A couple of other numbers you can represent. Everything is 0, then the number is 0. The sign bit doesn't really matter. The sign bit set, everything else is 0, that's still 0. Sometimes that's called negative 0. If all the exponent bits are set, but the mantissa bits are all 0, that's a special number. That's infinity. The sign bit tells us if it's positive or negative infinity. If all the exponent bits are set and at least one mantissa bit is set, that's another special number called a NaN. It stands for not a number. It's useful for when you divide by 0 or take the square root of a negative number. It doesn't matter which mantissa bit or how many are set. Now you can set your floating point number to a number, 0, infinity, or not a number. So let's represent 16.125 using a float. A float is a 32-bit number. We can represent the 16 with 10000. The fractional part is 0.001. That makes the binary number 10000. 0.001. To represent that in our scientific notation, we have 1.0000001 binary times 2 to the 4th. So now we have to place this all in our floating point bits. The sign is positive, so that's 0. 0 goes into the 32 bit. The exponent is 4. Now remember, we need to bias this number, so that makes our exponent 127 plus 4, or 131. We store 131 into bits 24 through 31, and that's this number. The last bit is the mantissa. Our scientific binary number is 1.000001. We know the first digit is 1, so we don't bother storing that. We just store the 0000001 for the mantissa, and the rest of the digits are 0. So there's our final number, and that is what gets stored into a float. A double is just a bigger float. It uses 1 bit for the sign, 11 bits for the exponent, and 53 bits for the mantissa. It gives you more precision and bigger values. So those of you paying attention at home are thinking, wait, 1 plus 11 plus 53, that's 65. This is a 64-bit number. What gives? Well, if you remember, the first digit of your mantissa is always a 1, and we never store it. It's an implied bit. That's why we use the scientific notation. That way, we know the first bit is always a 1, and we get it for free. Let's go create some floats and doubles. To create the types in Java, we use the same pattern we did for integer types. We give the type, either float or double, then we give it a name for our number, and then possibly a value. When defining a float, you need to add the letter F to the end of your literal. That tells Java it's a float. If you leave it off, Java thinks your literal is a double. You can add D to the end of your double literals for clarity, but the default is just double. Luckily, we don't have to do all that bit manipulation to create our numbers. We can assign our float as a decimal literal, either as a floating point number or as a number in scientific notation. You can use a lowercase or uppercase e. In this particular case, Java's case insensitive. We run the app, and it prints the numbers back out. Let's go try creating that error where we assign a double to a float. We'll try creating a float, then assigning a number without the F at the end. And we get that lossy conversion error again. That's okay though, because most of the time you're going to be working with doubles. There's really little use for using floats these days. You can also set the numbers to the special numbers we talked about before, using the float and double number classes. Here's what we do to set it as a NaN. We'll cover these classes later. We can set this to negative infinity, and we can do the same for doubles. When we run, it prints out the string for the value.
You probably noticed, if some of the digits are used to represent exponents, they can't be used to represent a particular individual number, you know, like in integers. This means that you have holes in your number line. It's just not possible to represent all numbers. Some floating point numbers just can't be represented in a float or a double. And if it can't be represented, it gets rounded to the closest number that it can represent.
This problem is even worse when you consider that some simple numbers can't be represented at all. Take the number 1 over 3, or 1 third. When you try to represent this as a fraction, it goes on forever. This is what we call a repeating decimal. You can have the same problem with binary numbers. So 1 over 3 doesn't work in decimal. Take 1 over 10, or 1 tenth. The decimal number is 0.1. Try this in binary. Take 10 in binary and divide by 1. You'll find that you'll get a repeating pattern in binary and the number will never end. This is something to remember, especially when you're trying to represent money. You can't represent 10 cents. That sounds crazy. So let's see this in action. Pretend we're adding 10 cents with 20 cents. That should give us 30 cents. We're going to format the print statement because the normal print statement is going to round our results. We'll print out the 16 decimal places for the float and 17 for the double. Run the program, and we get 30 cents, plus some random digits way out there. The more you add, the more that error will move to the right.
You should never ever use a primitive floating point number for money. So you're probably wondering, why use them at all if they are so error prone? The floating point primitive types are fast. You're exchanging accuracy for speed. Since floats and doubles fit into 32 and 64 bits, they are optimized for the instructions on your computer. There are instructions on your CPU to handle these data types in a few clock cycles. You'll often see these types used for graphics and for games. Most of the math routines in Java are also using doubles. So if you're not constrained for memory, always prefer the double. You get a bit more accuracy, and the performance penalty really doesn't show on modern computers. So that's the float and the double. There's a much better but slower thing you can use if you want more accuracy called the big decimal. We'll cover that later when we get to primitive classes. Up next, however, we'll look at the Boolean and the char primitives, and that will wrap it up for primitives.
Hey, thanks for watching the video. There's a quick quiz for this on DGU.com if you'd like to gauge how much you learned. If you like the videos you're seeing, please let me know by liking the video and hitting the subscribe button for the DGU channel on YouTube. I'd really appreciate that. If you have concerns or questions, please leave them in the comments below or on DGU.com. There's a poll on the front page of DGU.com, so you can also let me know what topic gets covered next. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.